Hi, this is Your Voice. I'm Julia Locony. Today, the Senate Finance Chairman is going to talk about his ideas for job creation, as well as the minimum wage regulations and his latest on redistricting, which affects you. How are you, Senator?
I'm doing well, thank you.
From talking to you here and listening to your debates and seeing you in news conferences and hearings, your take on the your economic development is that you can't have the decisions that are made on the government level to hit the people who create the jobs. Is that correct?
That's really correct. I mean, we've talked a lot about and are proud of the fact that we're cutting spending in the state of New York to balance the budget and to put the state in the right fiscal condition. But the problem is you can't continue to cut indefinitely without affecting important services. As a result, the only way we're going to get out of this fiscal difficulties is to grow the economy. And the only way you grow the economy is by creating jobs. And government just can't keep hiring people and say they created jobs. That's the fallacies that was happening in the last few years that caused part of the problem. What we have to do is get the private sector to create jobs. So we have to have a tax policy that makes that happen.
And the Senate has already, ahead of the budget, the Senate passed a plan, comprehensive plan that would reduce broad-based taxes. One would cut the tax rate for small businesses from 6.5 to 5.2%. How much would this save? How many businesses would be impacted?
Well, it's difficult to say. All we know is that when taxes have been cut in the past, especially for small businesses, they've been able to hire. Whenever you impose another regulation, which costs a small business money, whenever you impose another tax, which causes small business money, they obviously don't have the funds to hire somebody and to create more product, whatever it may be, or provide more services, and the economy keeps contracting. So we want to go in the way that has been proven in the past that works, leave more money in the hands of the small business person so that that person, that small company, can hire people. And that new hiree is going to pay taxes. So that's the way you grow out of a problem. And the small, providing a 10% tax credit for small businesses that hire someone, that helps pay for that salary. And in the long run, that's going to bring back more taxes and income taxes than the tax break we're giving in the first place. By reducing the tax rate of small businesses, once again, more dollars are in their pockets. Now, you mentioned that we passed this before the budget. We did this because we were trying to get this proposal in the budget. Unfortunately, the Assembly and the governor would not agree to this package, but we still have a couple of months left in session, and we're trying to advocate for it and to try to get this back on the front burner.
Right. You talked about the 10% cut. Let's take a look at who would be eligible for that. It would be a credit for hundreds of thousands of small businesses that have at least one employee, have business income of less than $250,000, and file under a personal income tax.
That's basically what it is. And, as a result, we're trying to get the startup companies, the smaller companies, to be able it's not only startup, but companies have been around for a long time that are earning less than $250,000. That affects a lot of small businesses. There's a lot of small businesses out there, and they're the ones that are struggling. And the small business, by the way, is the one in the state of New York that's really created the most jobs over the last decade. And that's the engine of the economy in the state of New York. And as a result, if we provide this break, we'll make it easier for them to be successful. And we're, you notice the amount of money that we're talking about, the income, $250,000 or less, this whole class warfare that's going on in the national elections. We don't want to be criticized for helping the so-called rich. But quite frankly, it works for any business, any size, whether it's we're limiting it at $250,000 income or not. And we would love to expand it, but we want to start at something that may have a chance of actually happening.
Right, you got to start somewhere. What's being done to reduce the cost of energy for businesses?
Well, when the Senate was in control of the other party in the 2009-2010, that was the time when taxes were increased by $14 billion, spending was increased by $14 billion. Well, one of the taxes that was increased was the tax on your utility bill. There was a tax put on that. And what we're trying to say, all right, now we're in a different time. Energy costs affect these small businesses just like any other cost. We want to get rid of that surcharge in steps to try to go back to the way it was before these onerous taxes were put on that adversely affected small businesses. So that's another component of it. And it also, I think, would assist the individual as well with their utility bill, because that surcharge was placed on every utility bill. So we're trying to roll that back as well.
Right. That initiative with some other initiatives that was passed last year, you mentioned HOME, that would be the Power New York, Recharge New York. These energy costs will be lower and businesses will be able to hire more people.
Well, they'll be able to make money. I mean, that's the whole point of, you know, it's easy for someone who is going to a job from 9 to 5 and saying, well, you know, why should they get a tax break and I'm not going to get that? But as a practical matter, if you're a small business owner, you don't ever leave that business. And in order to make it successful, you've got to make money. If you don't make money, well, obviously, then that business is not going to occur or not going to be successful, and it's not to continue. And you're not going to expand, and the expansion is what we want. The expansion of the economy is necessary because we just can't cut indefinitely without affecting vital services.
Another part is you want to get New Yorkers ready to compete in a global workplace. And for those who are ready to go to college but need financial assistance, how are you going to help them?
Well, financial assistance is important for college students. And we have, in this last year's budget, provided for funding for the TAP program. And we've provided the dollars that will at least help them to a certain extent in helping to pay their college costs. There was a lot of talk that maybe we would have had to cut the TAP program, the tuition assistance program for college students. And as a practical matter, we were able to save that in these budget negotiations and actually increase it a little bit. On community colleges, we provided a greater benefit to the community colleges based upon the number of students that they have. I think it was increased like $150 per person that are in the community college, which allows them to keep the tuition lower. So that's what we try to do in this year's budget.
One measure also would be to pay respects to veterans who come back from active duty, and it also would help businesses get a tax credit.
Yes, if you're hiring veterans, the same concept. Hire a veteran and you get a tax incentive up to $10,000. Now, to me, there's two parts of that. Number one, it's fair. The veterans have, in some cases, gone overseas 2, 3, 4 times in harm's way. So it's really a benefit to the veterans that they've well earned 10 times over. But secondly, I think we're not necessarily even just doing the veterans a favor. We're basically getting quality people who are disciplined people that are going to be good employees, and by hiring that veteran, you're going to have a good employee that's going to also help your business to grow. So each of these incentives in and of themselves cannot do it, but on the other hand, all together we may be able to create some jobs as a result of it.
As the finance chair, I'd like to get your where you are on the issue of minimum wage. New York's minimum wage is aligned with the federal standards, which is $7.25, and there's a proposal from the Assembly Speaker to raise it to $8.50. He's calling it a moral issue.
Well, what's a moral issue is getting people to work, and if you're going to increase costs to businesses, it's the exact opposite what we were just talking about. So if you're going to raise the minimum wage, it's not just the lower income people wages are going to be raised, but the next person in line, you can't keep them at the same wage, so that the wages are going to go up. And to impose an additional cost, I think, is counterproductive to the actual goal that we're trying to do, is to make it more profitable so they can hire more people. And secondly, it affects adversely young people, whether it's high school kids or college kids. They have minimum wage jobs. If a movie theater is going to hire 10 ticket takers, they may have to hire 9 if the economy is bad and they're not getting the income that they otherwise get. Now, the important thing as far as morals is concerned, the state of New York and the federal government provide a low an earned income tax credit. And what that does is that it offsets the credit, if you're a low-income earner, it offsets what taxes you would otherwise pay. So in addition to the current minimum wage, there is a credit against the taxes you would otherwise pay. So that's a benefit to the low wage earner. In addition, if your wages are so low that you don't incur enough taxes that would be offset by the credit, you actually get a check. And a check comes to you, the earned income tax credits, not just an offset of taxes. The state of New York paid out approximately $800 million worth of these credits. And as a practical matter, that's additional revenue to low-income earners. So morally, with the earned income tax credit and the current minimum wage, we're morally doing the right thing without incurring having businesses incur greater costs. So that's my analysis of it. And our moral issue is really getting people back to work. And to get people back to work, you've got to create jobs. And that's what small businesses do if they earn income.
Right. With the elections around the corner, what is going on with redistricting? When are people going to know who they are going to vote for?
Well, the courts, in every redistricting that's happened in the last 30 years, every 10 years they happen, there's always been court challenges. There's court challenges over the issue of whether we can increase the Senate seats from 32 to 62 to 63. We won the first round of that in court. It's going up on appeal. There's challenges claiming that the districts are unfairly drawn because they don't adequately provide an opportunity for minorities to win some of these seats. That is absolutely incorrect, but there's a challenge on that basis as well. That's in the courts. We should be having some decision actually by the end of April, and then no doubt there'll be some other challenges that come up. But since petitions have to be circulated in the early June, by middle of May, there has to be a determination by the courts, and the courts will fast track this to make sure the determination is done. My guess, what was announced a few weeks ago, the final district lines, I think are going to be the lines, but until the court proceedings are over, we won't have certainty on it.
What about the people who are calling for earlier primaries? How would that even happen?
I don't know how you can have an earlier primary if we provide the district lines, and the district lines are being challenged by various individuals for various reasons, and it's still working its way through the court system. So as a practical matter, I don't know how you could do that. You can't do that. So it's nice to theoretically make these arguments, but as a practical matter, it's not possible. It would have been possible instead of September to do it, say, in August, but the judge who made the determination on the primary dates for the congressional seats decided it was going to be in June. Now, and that's a problem. We all respect our judges. I'm a lawyer, and I think judges do a great job. But sometimes judges don't understand the political realities of life. You don't set a June primary for the congressional people and then think that the legislative seats for the state government are going to take place in June when there's going to be challenges on the district lines that are going to go almost up to June. So as a practical matter, it's going to be impossible to do it because of the court challenges, and I think most people recognize that.
Yeah, and it's important for New Yorkers to know who the representatives so they can make informed decisions.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Thank you so much for being with us, Senator.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For more detailed information on the economic development plan we discussed, you can log on to the Senator's website, defrancisco.nysenate.gov.